The Southern Ocean, home to the most extraordinary ocean current on our planet, the Antarctic Circumpolar Current. Unhindered by land, strong winds freely steer the ocean's waters, pushing 130 million cubic meters of water around Antarctica every second. This clockwise whirl keeps warm waters from reaching the South Polar region, protecting the Antarctic ice sheet. Ocean currents play a crucial role in stabilizing climate, especially here as we near the South Pole. Recently, the mighty glaciers of Antarctica have experienced dramatic melt, and most of this could be attributed to the effect of warming ocean waters. In 2010, the Integrated Ocean Drilling Program Expedition 318 collected sediment cores around Antarctica. They reveal surprisingly high temperatures during the Eocene warm interval between 34 and 56 million years ago. During this period, Antarctic shorelines were covered with lush green forests, no ice to be seen anywhere. Peter Bijl, paleoceanographer at the University of Utrecht in the Netherlands, and his team are trying to solve the mystery of the apparent high temperatures on Antarctica during the warm early Eocene period.
The sediment cores that we analyzed from this expedition was so exciting because we finally got an insight into how Antarctica looked like in this super warm greenhouse climates. What it also caused is some suspicion whether our reconstructions were really correct, because it was so warm and it was so tropical vegetation that we found in those sediment cores that people started to doubt this warm forest of Antarctica.
These warm conditions coincided with high concentrations of atmospheric carbon dioxide, as well as with fundamentally different positions of some key land masses.
Way back when, in the Paleocene and Eocene, Australia and South America were much closer to Antarctica than they are today. They prevented the Antarctic Circumpolar Current to develop.
Just before the warm greenhouse Eocene, during the Paleocene, the world was cold. Not as cold as it is today, but much colder than thought possible in a greenhouse climate. The sediments from IODP Expedition 318 revealed that the first signs of cooling following the warm Eocene period coincided with the first flow of ocean water through the Tasmanian Gateway. Were the warm Eocene and colder Paleocene caused by variations in carbon dioxide concentrations alone? Or did the fundamentally different current patterns around Antarctica play an important role too? Peter Bijl realized that both the northern part of the Tasmanian Gateway in modern-day southern Australia and the Drake Passage in Patagonia could contain critical information. Peter and his team set out to collect samples to help answer these questions.
We went to South Australia on the coastline. There's cliffs which actually represent Paleocene, Eocene sediments. They were vertical cliffs which are directly outcropping, so we could nicely sample them. And I had the fortunate situation to know a good climber who was a colleague scientist. And we brought him with us to also help reconstructing these climates on the South Australian margin, but also take the advantage of the fact that he could actually rope us up and bring us up to the cliffs safely. What we found there was that the vegetation on South Australia was much warmer compared to the Antarctic vegetation that we reconstructed. And that is a clear validation that there are thermal gradients in the Southern Ocean, definitely, and they caused a different vegetation regime on Antarctica and on Australia.
The tectonic opening of the Tasmanian Gateway is reasonably well understood, but the opening of the other gateway at Drake Passage is much more complex and yet just as crucial for the development of the Antarctic Circumpolar Current. To further this, Peter Bijl and his team went to remote Patagonia in early 2016, where Paleocene-Eocene marine sediments are exposed and accessible on land.
In tectonically active area, we can take the advantage that tectonic processes has moved these old marine sediments upwards, so that they basically come available on land, and you just walk around in the region and you can analyze really old marine sediments.
They collected 125 kilograms of samples from a number of sites where rocks are exposed, in collaboration with regional experts from Chile and Argentina. They have since been analyzing these samples in the laboratory at the University of Utrecht. 24 already, yeah. A lot of work needs to be done to reconstruct the story the sediments have to tell about the past.
We cannot just look at the sediments by eye and reconstruct ocean currents. Okay, so for that we need to look at what's in these sediments, and particularly on a micro scale. So the remains of microplankton can tell us a lot about how these ocean currents were directed in those field areas. So now we're going to process these samples, sample by sample, and reconstruct for each sample what kind of microplankton is in there, and do all kinds of other biomarker analysis, organic geochemical analysis. By combining all these samples and all this information, you can actually start to reconstruct changes in the ocean currents through time. And that can eventually tell us something about the development of the Antarctic Circumpolar Current as a result of the opening of these gateways.
This study will give us insights into the interplay between ocean currents and local climate. Specifically, as we go from a colder, but apparently isoline Paleocene, to the super greenhouse conditions of the Eocene, as well as the exact timing and climatic consequences of the opening of both gateways. Peter Bijl and his team continue to investigate the various stages of development of the Antarctic Circumpolar Current to its present-day strength and its effect on the climate and ocean systems.